All right, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
We're small in number today. Like, a lot of people still stay at home, and that's fine. I understand that completely. Thank you for coming out, and we're actually just encouraging people to do what you feel comfortable doing. If you don't feel comfortable being in a crowd, then please don't feel pressure. Don't feel anything other than we want you to stay home, stay healthy, and do whatever you need to do to make you feel safe with all this going on. But I apologize. We were a little late because traffic held us up. They were trying to get some big old thing through the light back over here and had it all shut down. And it finally opened up. I'm just glad we were able to come together and see each other a little bit, and just a few at a time. And it's really good to have everybody here today. And maybe some others will join us here in a minute, but if not, that's okay. Just want to let you know that Rhonda and I have, my mask will not stay up, but Rhonda and I have been cleared by our doctors. They said we cannot get it, and we cannot give it. But we're going to keep, so we're immune for a while until immunity wears off, but we're wearing our mask just to make everybody else feel comfortable too with everybody else. We're just going to sing a few songs today here. We're going to try to streamline a little bit, but I got a really important word I think we really need to hear today. We're going to try to get the computer working. It's not working right now. There's got a glitch in it somewhere. And so if it's not one thing, it's a dozen others that the old devil trying to keep us from things happening the way we want them to happen. But maybe we'll get that going here shortly. And so Jerry's going to keep working on it. So just ignore whatever you see going on over here. And let's just focus on the Lord today. And let's just enter into His presence and ask Him to be with us. And we're just going to move forward with that today. Let's all stand today and let's pray as we open up. All right. One thing we did ask families to stay together and make sure we spread out and so that families and those kind of things you're with each other all the time, so you're okay. But just let's practice the social distancing. We rearrange the chairs so we have a little more distance between each other. So let's make sure we practice that. If you don't have a mask, there's masks out there in the foyer. You can use those if you need those. All right. Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus, that we can come together today, Father God. We may be a handful, a few in number, Lord. But God, we know that your presence is with us. We ask you, Father God, to be with us. Inhabit the praises of your people, Lord. I pray, Father God, that you'll just challenge our hearts. Minister to us today, Father God. Lead us and guide us. I pray you keep our congregation safe. I thank you, Father God, that you have kept us safe so far, Lord, and you're going to continue to do that, Lord. We thank you, Father God, that when Rhonda and I went through this, we didn't spread it to anybody. Nobody got it, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord. Even though we was in contact with a lot of people, Lord, God, nobody got it. We thank you for your protection. We thank you, Father God, for your goodness, your love, your grace, your mercy, Lord. Be with us today, Father God, as we celebrate you and we celebrate life in Jesus. We give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's worship the Lord today.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we have strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you in your kingdom. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new. You make us new. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Because when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Because when we see you, we find strength to face the day. Because in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hosanna, 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 you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna.
At the news and we see the things that are going on around the world, I see so many people that are hungry for something. They're searching for something. And the sad thing is they don't really know what that something is. We have the hope and we have the knowledge of what that something is, because that something is Jesus. We know that when we when we worship Him, when we live in His presence, we find peace and we find hope to face every day, no matter what is thrown our way. And here lately, there has been so much that has been thrown our way, just one right after the other. So my prayer for Bridgepoint Church today, my prayer for every person that's in this room, is that we rest in His peace and we find our hope where our true hope comes from. And that when we are out, whether it's at work or at the grocery store or wherever that may be, that we can be that light, we can be that hope that Jesus has placed in us. That His light and His strength and His love will shine through us so bright that they would find hope. And even if it's in that moment, whatever fears they're facing, even in that moment when they see us, even though they can't see our smiles behind our masks, they can see Jesus through us. That's my prayer for Bridgepoint Church today. That's my prayer for every person that enters this building and that drives down this street, is that when they see these flags waving, that they see hope, that it's a banner of hope. Amen. Because that's what we need in our world today. Jesus, we just love You today. Father, we lay down every care. We lay down every hurt, every anxiety, every fear at Your feet. Father, we embrace the hope that You are. Father, we embrace the peace that You are. And we just speak the name of Jesus. Because when we speak Jesus, everything else doesn't matter. Father, we praise You today. Jesus, we praise You today.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Lord, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Yeah. The blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joys. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. He's calling you, Lord, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Hey, the blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, what a Savior, sing it with us now. Lord, what a Savior, isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah, yeah. Christ is risen. Bow down before. For He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, yeah. Christ Christ is risen. Lord, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bear the cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasures you found. The treasures you found.
Song we're going to sing this morning. It's called Good, Good Father. And as we were practicing this morning of just, I just began to cry just to think of truly how good God is. You know, I don't know about the rest of you, but like, I've lost work. The whole month of July, I was down to working one day a week. And I'm hourly, and those days were 4 hours a day for one day a week, and that doesn't pay the bills. I have a wife and four kids, and it doesn't pay the bills, but yet, we never went without. God still provided, because he's a good, good father, and I think of that in my own life with my own kids, that they don't go without. We may not always get what we want. We may not always have what we want, but God always provides what is needed. And it's always just enough and in the exact time that we need it. And just worship with us this morning and truly think of how good God is, of such a good, good Father that he loved us enough to give his son. He loved us enough to send his son to die for us. Yes, Lord.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. And I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm
loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. 'Cause you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, you're perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love, you're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. You're a good, good Father. To you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Yes, Father.
Amen. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you are a good Father. You love us unconditionally. Even when we mess up and we fail, you always reach out your loving arms. You're ready to pick us up out of the miry clay and put us on a solid rock. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you love us so much that you gave your life for us. And we celebrate that today. We lift you up and exalt you today because you are our Lord, our Savior. And we have a Heavenly Father who loves us deeply, more than we can even think or imagine. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise today, Lord Jesus. We give you praise, Heavenly Father. because you are our provider. You are our source. You are the one who lifts our head and you sustain us. We thank you, Lord. We give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for being here today. Aren't you glad we have a good Father? Amen. Let's give the Lord a clap offering today. Amen. All right. God bless you. You may be seated. All right. Once again, thank you, everybody, for coming out today. Thank you for being with us. The video we're going to post online, so if you're watching this video a little later on this afternoon, thank you for joining us. Thank you for clicking on that and watching us. I believe we have a relevant word for you today. All right. Well, before I jump into this word, I just want to let you know there's a few things we want to do, and at the time, we'll look and see how things play out a little bit. We're still playing a little by ear of what's what everything going on, the coronavirus thing, and so we're just going to keep kind of trying to play it by ear just a little bit and see what we need to do. And we're asking the Lord for wisdom and guidance, and you know, the Lord protects us, He keeps us, but He also has given us common sense, right? And so sometimes we need to follow that, and God wants us to do that. So we're going to keep strategizing and see what we need to do to keep moving forwards and for the Lord Jesus Christ. So just hang on to all that. One thing we want to do is if we are open up to the public, maybe in the fall, whenever we're able to do that, we want to get this back wall finished and get the TVs hung up here and get that screen out of the way and get a platform extended out and do some things like that in here. Get the walls painted all one color and those kind of stuff. That's what we want to do inside here. Then outside, we want to get some of those walls tore out and create more of a fellowship area so we'll have opportunity to hug and fellowship when we're allowed to do that again, right? Without the fear, but still social elbow bump, whatever we need to be doing, toe tap, however you meet and greet these days, and we'll keep doing those kind of things. But we'll probably, when we do open back up, we do get the fellowship thing. Basically, we'll have individual coffee cups, and that's pretty much all we'll do is coffee and individual things where you can fix your own stuff up, and there won't be any kind of community type thing going on there for a while. So we're gonna try to make sure we follow some of those rules and regulations. All right. Well, today, let's get to the message. You ready? We're continuing our series called The Seven. It's the churches of Revelation and us. How do we apply what Jesus spoke to those churches? How do we apply it to our lives today? I just noticed we got the computer running. Yay! All right. All right. Very good. Thank you, Jerry. All right. So today we're in week 5 of our series called The Seven, and The Seven is going to have 8 weeks. We're in series 5. We got, actually, it will be 7 weeks as we combine two together. We got 2 more weeks of the series called Seven. This is the 5th message to the churches of Revelation 2 and 3, and today we're going to be talking about Sardis and being spiritually alert. Being spiritually alert. Sardis, give you a little history on the city, and this is where the church was located. It was a hustling and a bustling and a booming economy. It was really going great, but then it suffered a deep decline. It kind of collapsed upon itself. While other cities in the area were still booming, other cities in the area were growing, had a lot of activity. Where Sardis once was that way, now it finds itself just a shadow of its former self. And now all it can do is just reminisce about the good old days. Just reminisce about all those things, all the glory days and all the prosperity that they had had. Now all that is gone. Sardis was one of the oldest, and it was a major, very important city in Asia Minor. It was actually a very political city. It was a capital. It had a lot of stuff going on, and it was noted for its fruits and its wool. It was a great producer of those kind of things, and it found gold in the river. There was a river that ran through the area, and it had a lot of sand in there. And they discovered gold, and here is where they first had gold or silver stamped and made into coins. This is the first place where this happened, was in Sardis. And here are some of the beautiful coins that they had made back. These are the very first coins ever made on record. So it has some pretty cool things, pretty innovative for that time period. And so these are some awesome coins that they had made during that time period. So Sardis retained its wealth for the first couple of centuries of the Christian era, but then its political brilliance in the capital city now all lays in the past. And there's a sad lesson in the history of Sardis where it had the great prosperity, now lies very desolate. It did not endure. The citizens lacked foresight and looking ahead to preserve its future. At the end of the first century, the city was a sad contrast between its past splendor and its current present-day decay because it didn't look forwards. Think about that one for a minute. Revelations 3, 1 through 6 is the letter that Jesus wrote to the church. And here's what he says. In verse 1 of Revelation 3, he says, "Write this letter to the angel of the church of Sardis." So the message from the one who has the sevenfold spirit and of God and the seven stars. "I know all the things you do and that you have a reputation for being alive, but you're dead. Wake up. Strengthen what little remains, for even what is left is almost dead. I find that your actions do not meet the requirements of my God." Strengthen, you have a reputation of being alive, but you're dead. Strengthen what remains, because your actions don't meet the requirements of God. He said, "Go back to what you heard and believed at the first. Return back to those things. Get back." He said, "Repent and turn to me again. If you don't wake up," he's giving the warning here, "if you don't wake up, I will come to you suddenly as an unexpected, as a thief. Yet there are some," now here's the good things. He goes, "Yet there are some in the church of Sardis who have not soiled their clothes with evil. They will walk with me in white." And white represents purity, you know that. "For they are worthy. All who are victorious," everybody say all? "All who are victorious will be clothed in white, and I will never erase their names from the book of life." I will never erase their names from the book of life. That tells me my name is erasable. I must be victorious. I have to overcome. I have to do these things that he called us to do. We have to repent, make sure we move forward so our names aren't... We can be right and then fall away. "I will never erase their names in the book of life." That means it once had to have been there. "But I will announce before my Father and his angels that they are mine." Anyone who has an ear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches. So here's the letter to Sardis, and the history of Sardis was a great illustration of the timeless message of Jesus. What is that timeless message? Don't go to sleep. You can never, ever sleep, right? Now, he's not talking about a physical sleep. He's talking about a spiritual sleep. Never go to sleep. Remain spiritually alert. Have you ever been driving when you started getting really drowsy and you kind of got to slap yourself, roll the windows down, get some fresh air, or something like that, and you're like, "Oh man, I really should pull over," but you're trying to keep yourself alert. And sometimes during life, we need to make sure that we're staying spiritually alert. Make sure that we are doing what God has called us to do. Just don't go to sleep. Let's remain spiritually alert. Even though the Sardinians had enjoyed great success, their future they failed to remain alert, and twice had been found themselves under a surprise attack from the enemy. Sardis had fortified walls. It was a great place, should have been easily defended, but they began to lax themselves and become very comfortable, like, no big deal, and all of a sudden, bam, when they least expected it, the enemy come in and capture them. Twice in their history, this happened. Even though they had the great, easily defended walls, they found themselves under attack. the same way with the Holy Spirit in our lives and church and all the Christian things and support, the things we can learn and that are available to today, we can easily find ourselves under attack. So we need to be very careful. Jesus here gives the warning to the church of Sardis, and I believe it's also for us today. He said, you think you are alive. He says, you think you are alive. You've put on a good face. You put on the facade. You're acting like you're alive. You got a pulse. He says, but you are dead. You think you're alive, but you are dead. And this is what we need to hear today, to wake up and shake off our spiritual drowsiness. This is the call to the church. I had a client I was doing some work for here a while back, and I said, where do you attend church? And he goes, well, we go to this church over here and name the church, and I'm not condemning any church, but she goes, well, it's kind of church light. And I'm like, church light? I said, yeah, it's just pretty shallow. And I'm like, really? She goes, well, there's different people in different journeys of life, whatever, but it's kind of church light for us a little bit. I'm like, okay, is church light okay? You know, I mean, if you like, you know, like Miller Lite, that's not what we're talking about, right? No, we don't need church light. We don't need church light. We need to be a strong, we need to wake up. We need to wake up and shake off that spiritual drowsiness. Jesus said twice in this letter to wake up. He said twice, and I think that's what we need to do today, is wake up. Stay awake. Stay spiritually alert. Keep our spiritual discernment going about us. It's a spiritual condition of readiness and being alert. He says, I will come as a thief. I will come as a thief. That's why it's so important for us to hear today, because we do not know when Jesus is going to come. He says, those who do not maintain spiritual awareness will be a surprise when Jesus returns. Well, let me tell you, Jesus is going to come back. And I think we need to be living like he's going to come back today. We need to be living a life that he's going to come back soon. And we need to be living like that, alert and awake and looking for his return, so it is not a surprise to us. Jesus said in Matthew 24, verse 36, he said, however, no one knows the day or the hour when these things will come. These things will happen. Not even the angels in heaven or the Son himself. Only the Father knows. This scripture context was the apostles that asked Jesus, and hey, give us a sign for when you return. We know you're going to go away. We know you're going to come return back. Give us a sign about that. And Jesus begins to talk to them and begins to tell them, said, you know, look for a sign. He goes, man is going to be when nation rises up against nation. We see those things. He said, when there's earthquakes and there's famine and there's wickedness running rampant through the city. When we see all these things, and it refers to the prophecy of Daniel, all these things that are happening, he goes, these are signs that I'm coming back soon. Then he gives them three different parables of how to know when he's coming back soon and why we should be prepared. So the first parable that he begins is a lesson about the fig tree. In Matthew 24, verses 32 and 33, Jesus says, now learn a lesson from the fig tree. When its branches bud and its leaves begin to sprout, you know that summer is near. When you see the leaves turning green, when you see the flowering, I love spring. I love when all that begins to happen. And you know all the life and all the green things start to come place, and you're like, oh, man, we're moving into summertime. It's going to be pretty quick. It's going to be getting hot. Right now we've got good rain showers, good things happening, and we know the season that it's setting up. We're ready to move into summer, and then we know when summer begins to bake and cook everything for a long time. We know that then begins. We notice a change in the air. We know it's about to become fall. Then we notice when it comes back in the wave. We notice the changing of the seasons. You begin to sense it in the air. You begin to sense the angle of the sun, and the shadows are shifting, and all these different things. We begin to notice that we know that the seasons are changing. And Jesus said, when you see these things happen, you know that the summer is near. He goes, in the same way, when you see all these things, you can know his return is very near and at the door. when we begin to see the wars and rumors of wars, when we see the famines, we see the earthquakes, we see all the devastation, we see all the crazy things that are going on, we have to look around and say, wow, time is near. We need to be alert and awake. That's why I think this is a very timely and relevant message for us today. It's because we see everything happening. We need to be alert. We see the seasons changing. Jesus then explained that his return would surprise many people, just as it did the flood in Noah's day. In Matthew chapter 24, verses 37 through 34, Jesus starts the second parable, and he says, when the Son of Man returns, it will be like it was in Noah's day. In those days before the flood, the people were enjoying banquets and parties and weddings right up to the time Noah entered the boat. What does that mean? I mean, they were going about all the things of life, all the stuff that this life had to offer, all the pleasures, all the fun, all the exciting things that was about this life, and their eyes were focused on the immediate and not the future. Their eyes were not thinking long term. It was about the immediate gratification, about the immediate things right there. And remember what happened to Sardis? They didn't plan for the future. It was all about what's immediate right now. Here's what happened. They didn't plan. They were just doing all about going all the distractions of life, all the banquets, all the parties, all the activities. And boy, are we not a busy culture today. We have so much busyness going on, so much crazy stuff going on. We could just run every night of the week. We have just all day long, in and out. We have a very hectic lifestyle. But we're chasing all these things. And he says, it's like the day of Noah. The people didn't realize what was going to happen until the flood came and swept them away. That is the way it will be when the Son of Man comes. So there's a lot of distractions going on. A lot of things are happening. We need to make sure that we're staying focused. It's okay. Do these things, but stay focused. It's okay. Go celebrate weddings. Go celebrate things. Go celebrate birthdays. Go have fun, but keep Christ the center. Keep Jesus the focus. Make sure we're not distracted and we don't just give into that immediate gratification. Like, you know, Jesus went to the weddings where he performed his first miracle, right? He wasn't against weddings. It's not against those things. It's just staying focused while you're doing that. Make sure that does not become the main thing, but Jesus is the focus 24/7. So then he says this in verse 40. He said, two men will be working together in the field. One will be taken, the other left. Two women will be grinding flour at the mill. One will be taken, the other left. What a surprise. You're doing your business. You're doing work. Like, whoa! Rapture takes place. The snatching away. The Jesus, you know, snatching away to be with him. Like, whoa, what happened here? It was a surprise. He says, so you too must keep watch, for you don't know what day the Lord is coming. When you least expect it, expect it. That's when Jesus is coming. He says, understand this. If a homeowner knew exactly when the burglar was coming, he would have kept watch and not permitted his house to be broken into. He would have known. He would have stayed alert. He would have made sure it didn't happen. He says, but you also must be ready all the time. We can't let our guard down. We need to make sure we're staying focused 24/7. Even we should maybe even be dreaming about Jesus, you know. And every now and then I have dreams, but it's like we need to be really focusing on the Lord, for the Son of Man will come when you least expect it. So we need to expect it when you're not expecting it, right? We need to know Jesus could come at any moment. And then finally, he gives a third parable. The third parable is about the 10 virgins, and I'm going to paraphrase this just a little bit. The first verse in verse 5, Matthew 25:5, it says, the five were wise and five were foolish. They all went out to meet Christ, the bridegroom. They all went to the wedding. They all waited, and the bridegroom, Jesus, was delayed, it says. But the only five had the foresight, remember that word, foresight, to take sufficient oil for the lamps. That must mean that the others, like, I got enough to get by. I got enough to get by. It should be fine, you know. I don't have to get too deep in the Lord. I probably got enough to get to heaven, right? I probably got enough to get in the door. I probably got enough just to get in by the skin of my teeth. No, they caught them. So they found themselves, and they found themselves, they did not have sufficient oil. that when the announcement that Jesus was coming, here he comes, and they all woke up from their slumber and their sleep. They got up, and they realized that they did not have enough oil to get in. They had to go run out and buy some because they had not prepared for the future. We need to make sure that we're prepared. We need to make sure that we are ready for the Lord. We need to be full and overflowing of the Lord and His Spirit flowing out of us. Let's make sure that we're ready every moment, that we are prepared. Let's don't just barely get into heaven, man. Let's get in all the way. Let's don't just sneak in. Let's be on fire today, because if we're just trying to sneak ourselves in, that probably means you ain't bringing nobody with you. But if we're excited, like, man, I'm ready. I'm going to keep alert, and I want you to be alert with me, because part of that alertness means you're warning others too. Hey, let's stay at work. Let's stay alert. Don't get distracted. We encourage. That's why it's important for us to gather together. That's why it's important for us to as iron sharpens iron. We need each other. We encourage each other. We strengthen each other. We need to be coming together. And hey, you got no oil in your lamp? I got a lot over here, but this is just for me. You got to get your own, buddy. You know, I can't get saved for you. I can't get filled with the Holy Spirit for you. I can't be overflowing for you. This is something you have to do for yourself. It almost makes the ones that had extra oil, it almost makes them sound greedy, because they're like, but the principle is you have to do it for yourself. I'm sure in real life they would have shared some oil, but this was the principle he was trying to say, was it's dependent upon you and not somebody else. We can't blame anybody else. We have to look for ourselves. And we have to grow spiritually for ourselves. We can use others to encourage us and strengthen us and help point us away. We need those strong mentors and people in our life to do that. But we have to make sure we're ready. So Jesus wraps that up with a moral of the story. Matthew 25:13, he says, watch therefore. What's the therefore? The therefore is everything we just talked about. Watch therefore. For you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. Once again, he repeats it. We don't know when he's coming. You need to be prepared for ourselves. So just like the parable of the 10 virgins, the message to Sardis shows the same importance of being spiritually prepared, spiritual preparedness. And so we can't go to sleep spiritually. We can't become lackadaisical. We cannot lose our zeal for a life in God's way. We can't lose our zeal for all that. And if we do, then we must repent. We must become spiritually alert once again. Jesus' instructions to Sardis emphasize this. He said they had become lethargic. They had lacked spiritual focus. They didn't have that 2020 focus. That's why we start off this year, 2020, with a 2020 focus for 2020. Why we want to stay focused. And part of this series is helping remind us to stay focused on the Lord. Let's don't be distracted by all the things in the world. Don't be distracted by all the stuff going on in the world other than make you want to pray for it. Let's just grieve. My heart has been grieved and heavy these last month or two. And it just grieves me, you know. And my heart hurts. So I know the Lord's heart is hurting. But we need to make sure we stay awake, spiritually sensitive of what's going on. We see the signs of the time. And we need to be focused, have that 2020 laser focus upon the future and not just immediate gratification of what's going on right now. He said, he warned them to wake up and be prepared for his return. He said, wake up. Your actions do not meet the requirements of my God. His requirements are simple. Don't fake it. Don't fake being alive. But be spiritually alive. Be truly alive. He said, in the last days, I will pour out my Spirit. I will pour out my Spirit. And if we're truly getting closer, moving towards the last days, then we need to make sure that we are spiritually alert. Let Him pour out His Spirit upon us. Let our oil vials or whatever they carry those things in, let it be filled, overflowing. Let our hearts be filled and overflowing to the Lord. We cannot become spiritually drowsy. We must be spiritually alert. He told him, he said, go back to what you heard and believed at first. Go back to what you heard and believed at first. We talked about the, The very first church we talked about, you lost your first love. Go back to those things that made you fall in love again. We return back to those things that made us fall in love with Jesus. The faith, the message that we heard at the very first, that's what we need to hang on to. That's what we need to make sure we're staying strong and firmly grounded in Him. Return to what we heard and believed at first. Hold on to it firmly, he said. And he said, repent and turn to me again. Lord, help America turn back to you again. We were started, we were founded as a great nation on Christian values, principles, and precepts. But as we move God farther and farther out and farther away and become spiritually sleepy and spiritually dead, we could very well follow the path of Sardis. And where I don't want to have to look back if the Lord should tarry and say, man, I remember when. I remember when we were a great nation, but we forgot God. We become lax. We begin to live for the immediate, and we forgot about the future. We need to make sure that we're staying spiritually alert. And I think we as a church, we as Christians, across this nation, across this world, we need to be spiritually vigilant, spiritually awake, spiritually alert, because we have to believe time is short. I think we can see the signs of the times. I think we can sense the seasons changing and see where we are. But here's the good news. The bottom line is this. He said, with all this being said, with all the doom and gloom that Pastor just talked about, right? Oh, so encouraging, right? But with all this being said, there is a reward for being awake. Aren't you glad? He rewards those who are faithful. He rewards those who diligently seek Him. He's a reward for all those. And he promises a reward. He gives them instructions to be spiritually alert. And then he says in Revelation 3, 4, and 5, he said, you have a few names, even in Sardis, who have not defiled their garments. He goes, hey, in the midst of all of this stuff going on, in the midst of all those that fall away for the self-gratification, all those that fall away for the immediate things, there's a few that kept their eye on the prize. There's a few names that stayed close to me and was looking to the future. He said, they have not defiled their garments, and so they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. Let's keep our eyes focused on the Lord. Let's be some of those who, if it falls away, say, oh, there's a few. And let's be a part of that few. Jesus said the gate is narrow. The road to that gate is narrow. The broad is the wide is the road to destruction. Narrow is the gate. Only a few find it. Let's be a part of the few. He says, he who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments. We will be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name or her name or their name from the book of life. So if we keep our garments white, if we stay following Jesus, stay alert, he goes, man, there's not a chance in the world I'm ever even going to consider that I'm going down there like anybody's name needs to be erased out of here. No. He's going to say, your name is going to be printed in ink. You ever just pencil something in? You know why you pencil it in? So you can erase it later. But when you put it in ink, it's there, right? Jesus says, I'm going to put your name down, and it will not be blotted out. It will not be erased from the book of life. He goes, but I will confess their names before my God and before his angels. I just can't wait for that day when we stand before the Lord, and he goes like, Nova Pittman, come forward. You get to enter in. You know, and I could begin to call all your names. And I want to stand. That's going to be an exciting moment. There's a lot of stuff going on here today. But if we stay focused on hearing our name, if we stay focused on wearing the garments of white, then we don't have a thing to worry about. So guys, if you're catching some of this stuff, kids, if you're like, I don't understand all that, and maybe if it makes you feel a little nervous, a little scared or whatever, don't be scared. There's a reward. There's a place to finish. And God gives us instructions all that he who has an ear, let him hear. So we still have ears. We can still hear today. So the message for us today is this. Remain spiritually alert. Let's be vigilant and watchful. Let's be alert and spiritually awake, because we do not know the day nor the hour. Let's don't live for the immediate. Let's live for the future. It's more fun sometimes to live for the immediate, but there's greater rewards living for the future. There's greater rewards living for the future. When we talk with young couples, we tell them, or even our sons and daughters, are like, don't just spend every dime you get. And, put some away for the future. We weren't very good at that early years. We didn't make much money. It took every dime we had to live, right? But it was like, but then we were like, okay, wait a minute. We got to start stowing away. So now we put money away. We put money aside. We're trying to, for the future. The same thing spiritually. We need to make sure we're banking spiritually so we don't find ourselves spiritually bankrupt. And we're going to be spiritually strong and have a great retirement in heaven. Amen? A permanent retirement in heaven where we just praise and worship the Lord and serve Him forever and ever and ever. So let's be alert. Let's be vigilant. Let's be watchful. And let's be awake because we don't know when He's coming. Let's pray today. Father, I thank You, Lord. I thank You, Father God, that You've given us warnings. God, and I pray, Father God, that You've given us ears to hear. So, Lord, we hear Your warning. We hear Your warning to the church. We hear Your warnings today, Father God, to us today as personally, and to the church in general. You've given us these letters. You've given us these words, Lord. Give us ears to hear. I pray, Father God, that if we're living for the moment, if we're living, Father God, for immediate gratification and not for a long term for You, Lord, I pray, Father God, today that we'll repent from that, Lord Jesus, our narrow, nearsighted vision, Lord. But God, give us a far-sighted vision. To be able to see far away, Lord, to have 20/20, to see the future and keep our eyes focused on the prize, the reward that is coming for those who kept their garments white. Keep us, Lord. Do not let us fall into temptation. Deliver us from the evil one, Lord Jesus. Make us spiritually strong. Make us spiritually vibrant. That God, that we will not just squeak by, but God will come by with flying colors, bringing crowds and crowds with us, Lord. Help us, Lord Jesus. Strengthen us today. We do not have to fear the future because we have our eyes on the future. And You're the one who holds it. We thank You, Lord Jesus. We thank You, Father. Lord, I just pray right now that if there's anyone here today that needs to repent, needs to shift their focus upon the future and not upon the immediate, Lord, I pray, Father God, that You'll challenge him right now. Holy Spirit, I ask You just to speak to their hearts. Those that are watching on video later, that are watching right now by video, I pray, Father God, that You'll touch your hearts, Lord. Challenge them, Lord Jesus, to repent and turn to You like never before. I pray, Father God, that You will give them 20/20 vision that sees deep into the future. Perfect vision to see the signs of the times of today. But God, we see the hope for tomorrow. And I pray, Father God, that You'll just strengthen each one. We ask You, Lord God, to pour out Your Spirit. Pour out Your Spirit upon all flesh. All flesh, Lord God. Pour it out, oh God. Let revival come. Let revival come, Lord. We give You all the praise. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, thank you so much for being with us today. God bless you. Preacher got a little long-winded today. But it's a good word. I believe it's for today. I believe it's God's word. Not my word. It's His word. His scriptures. His teachings. So, thank you so much. We're going to receive the offering on the way out. Jim, I believe the offering bucket's on the table outside. Or do you have it there? There you go. Jim's going to be by the door, so you can just drop your offering in the bucket on the way out so we don't have to pass the offering bucket. Thank you so much for being here. Let's pray and bless the offering and give you a blessed week today. Father, we thank You, Lord. I thank you, Father God, for those words you've given us, Lord. And God, we thank you for the opportunity to give back to you, Lord. I pray, Father, that you'll bless this offering, bless each gift and each giver, Lord. Multiply it to meet the needs. I pray, Father God, that we'll be blessed as we follow you, as we become spiritually awake, Lord. Bless each gift and every giver, Father God, in Jesus' name. Be with us this week, Lord. Give us a blessed week. I pray you'll keep each of our congregation and our families and our extended families, our friends, all those that we know, Lord God, I pray you'll keep them safe from this virus, Lord. I pray, Father God, that this will turn downward in our nation. I pray, Father God, that we'll see a steep decline, Lord. I pray, Father God, that you'll cause us to be able to open back up, Lord, and begin to worship fully before you. I pray, Father God, those that are struggling financially, Lord, because of this, I pray that you'll show yourself provider, Lord. I pray you'll keep them and protect them, Father. Those that need jobs, I pray, Father God, you'll open up doors of opportunity for them right now, Lord. In Jesus' name. Those that are in sales and need a miracle sales, I pray that you'll give them miracles, Lord. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Be our shield. Be our protector. As we keep our eyes upon you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Let's all stand today. Amen. Everybody have a blessed week. Stay safe. Love you all. God bless you. We'll watch your emails and notifications, and we'll see what happens next Sunday. But as of now, we're planning on being back. But just make sure you stay alert. We'll see what happens, okay? All right. Now, I'm not guaranteeing tomorrow, right? We're not guaranteeing nothing. So God bless you. Thank you so much. We'll see you soon.